Well, we're about to create some elements using the Pi System Explorer, but before we do that, let's just kind of go over some of the fundamentals of this asset database that we call AF. Remember, we start with elements that are either, well, they're either physically or they either represent physical entities or logical entities. So let's say that we've got this plant out here. This is a plant. I'm just going to label plant A. And within plant A, we've got a couple of different areas. So we'll just draw these lines to indicate there's, okay, this is an area over here. We'll call this area 1. And maybe there's another area called area 2. And those are part of that plant, and they represent two physical areas. So in this case, those are physical entities. Within those areas, you might have, oh, let's just divide this further. We've got a line 1 and a line 2 and a line 3. These are physical entities. And then within these lines, you might have the actual equipment. This might be a heat exchanger. So let's just call this exchanger A. We've got another exchanger here. This is called exchanger B. So that would be an example of how we've got physical entities aligned. But remember, these could also be organized under kind of logical entities. So underneath plant A, and something that spans both line 1 and line 2, you might have another whole hierarchy that you simply call exchangers. So if you're an exchangers would be something you would use, for example, for inventory purposes or maintenance purposes. So this would be something that the E&I managers, the electrical and instrumentation people, they would be interested in keeping track of all of these exchangers. Exchanger A, exchanger B, etc. All the different exchangers in your plant would be organized logically under this exchanger. So that's the first point to make about this, is that these are either physically aligned or physically located, or these can be some kind of a logical construct that you've got just for, you know, bookkeeping purposes more or less, or some kind of some other goal. Now, when you create something like this, we're seeing exchanger A, exchanger B, exchanger C. If you're kind of if you've been around these kind of systems for a while, you might start saying, hey, you know what, it would be kind of nice if I could do, instead of having to build each one of these exchangers and all the different things that go into this exchanger calculations, you know, the input, the outlet temperature, the tube side, etc., all those different metrics in constants, etc. Instead of having to build them from scratch each time you add a new exchanger to your system, it would be better to work with a template. And then that way, you know, once you've created that template, then each time you add a new exchanger, you just create a new unit from that template, and it simplifies things tremendously. So that's another thing to keep in mind. You know, when we create these elements, are we going to create these elements based on a template or based on just starting from scratch each time? Now, the analogy I like to use for that is imagine if you're making cookies with a cookie cutter shaped like a heart here, you could go ahead and stamp out as many cookies that are shaped like hearts as you want. And it makes it a lot more efficient, a lot easier. So that's what we're talking about with templates. We simply would like the option to be able to stamp out as many of these things as possible so that it simplifies the design and simplifies the implementation. Now, one place where this cookie analogy kind of falls apart, and a big feature of AF, is that imagine if you made changes to this template over here, to this cookie cutter, and all of a sudden all those changes appeared in all the cookies that had been stamped with that cookie cutter. Well, that's exactly the propagation that exists within AF when you make changes to this element template over here. An element template over there that changes, that template change is going to immediately propagate to all the things that are built based on that element template. Now, it's my preference when we discuss this in class to start by talking about these elements, these standalone elements that are built without a template. So as I said, you can build your own element, you know, without having to have that come from an element template. And that's where we're going to start, by building some standalone elements. Later on, we'll talk about creating these element templates. Yeah, it would be nice to talk about cookies before you start talking about cookie cutters. You know, if you don't know what a cookie is, it doesn't do much good to talk about these cookie cutters. So we're going to start our discussion by talking about these standalone elements, the elements you might create on your own without the benefit of a template. Now, in just a minute, we're going to go out to the Pi System Explorer and we're going to start creating these new elements. But before we can start creating these elements, we need to understand what these different reference types are. They're labeled composition, parent-child, and weak reference. Now, composition is what's known as a composition reference. This parent-child is a strong reference, and weak reference is a weak reference. So there's really only three types by default that we support: composition, strong, and weak. Yeah, this parent-child is the only one that doesn't have the name of the strength in the name of the reference type. So composition, strong, and weak. And I think that's the better way to think of these three. These are the default three reference types. You can actually create your own. So we need to explain these before we can get into the hierarchy. So let's take a look at a typical hierarchy. This is a hierarchy you'll find in your class workbook. In this hierarchy, let's talk about a composition reference type first. A composition reference type implies that the whatever is the parent is really the thing that defines the longevity or the lifespan of that object that you're referencing. So let me give you an example. Let's say this heat exchanger has a temperature transmitter called TT115.PV. This is a temperature transmitter. That temperature transmitter obviously is part of that heat exchanger. It's something that cannot live apart from the heat exchanger. If you were to take this heat exchanger out of service, well, this temperature transmitter would almost certainly come out of service as well. So if there is, if you have elements within an element, and those elements within the element are more or less dependent for their existence on that element, then you should make that a composition reference. And what that means is if you ever delete this, then we automatically delete the other elements that are underneath that. Now, that is the reference type that will allow or will take the greatest amount of resources on your machine when you're working, you know, with thousands of these references, because basically anything you do to this one is going to be done in mass to all the things underneath that. We typically see not a lot of these composition references. Now, what about the reference type called strong? Well, strong would be if you're trying to share objects among different parents. Like, for example, let's pretend that we've got a tank 1 and a tank 2. These are two tanks that are used for line A, but they're also used for line B. So, for example, we're going to be creating a structure that looks like that under line A, and then under line B, we're going to have a structure that looks like this, making reference to exactly the same tanks. So these are the same tanks here. This is tank 1 and tank 2. The same tank 1 and tank 2 you see over here. It's because, you know, we're storing intermediate components in there, and these two lines just happen to share the same tank farm. So we need to represent those, but we need to make sure that if you were to delete line A, we don't necessarily want to delete the references to tank 1 and tank 2 that you find down here. So those structures, tank 1 and tank 2, because they span different lines, it's something that should not have that composition reference where if we delete one of these lines, we automatically delete these tanks. Now, the last reference type is one called a weak reference. And you would use weak reference when you want the existence of the parent really not to have any effect on whether the child exists or not. See, up to this point, what we've described is the composition reference in which, you know, the life of the parent, if that is removed, if the parent, you know, is deleted, then that immediately deletes the child that has that composition reference. In the strong reference type, we said the deletion of all of the parents would result in the deletion of the child. So as long as one with a strong reference, more than one strong reference, as long as one strong reference exists, then we will not delete the element that has a parent that, you know, that still exists. So with the weak reference, what we're talking about here is we really don't want the, you know, whether the parent exists or not to have any effect on keeping that child alive. Now, I'll give you an example of why you might want to use that. Let's say, you know, back here with our heat exchangers, you know, this heat exchangers that we see right here, for the ENI folks, this represents the list of all the working heat exchangers. So we would probably want to have a strong relationship here so that, you know, this, maybe even a composite relationship here or a composition relationship such that, you know, if this heat exchanger is not in this list of working heat exchangers, then you'd probably want to delete it. Okay. And if we have a heat exchanger that shows up here under this hierarchy, if we delete it over here, we don't want the fact that there's a relationship right here to make this heat exchanger persist. In other words, if you were to delete this heat exchanger here, we would want that heat exchanger deleted elsewhere as well. Now, with the strong relationship, if you recall, with a strong relationship type or reference type, then as long as one parent remains, we don't delete the child. So if this right here were a strong relationship, then deleting it over here would have no effect. And that's what we do not want. So what we're suggesting is for those types of relationships, make these weak relationships. If either one of these is deleted from the list of working heat exchangers, then it's deleted from the hierarchy here as well. It doesn't persist over here simply because of this relationship right here. Now you can imagine if you've got some automated reports that are generated from this structure that you see right here in line A. So if the line A report comes out, you know, weekly, and in the line A report you see some information for heat exchanger A, and, you know, the unit manager says, hey, you idiot, didn't you know heat exchanger A is not, you know, it's not online anymore. We remove that. Well, you don't want this report to keep chunking out references to heat exchanger A when, in fact, heat exchanger A is not in the list of working heat exchangers anymore. So a weak reference would accomplish that. This element would simply disappear and your report would, you know, would break or do whatever you've programmed into your report when it's missing data. But at least you won't be reporting data that, you know, everybody else in the plant knows is no longer pertinent. To create elements, you go into the PI System Explorer and make sure in the navigation pane you've chosen the elements option. Yeah, don't choose any of the other options at this point. And from here, from the browser pane, what we do is a right mouse click and choose a new element. Now, when we first do this, the very first time we do this, if this is at the highest level of the hierarchy, which it is right now under elements, the only option available is going to be parent-child. So using the structure that we saw in our class workbook, I'll go ahead and create this thing called plant A. And there are no element templates here, so we're not going to be choosing this to be based on an element template. We'll talk more about that later on. So over here, I'll call this plant A, and I'll just leave that at that. No attributes at this point and no sub-elements. Now I can check that in, and that stores that. Now an alternate way to do this is to right mouse click on a specific element and choose new child element. That'll create a child underneath that element. If I chose element, it would be on the same level as the element that is selected. I'll choose a new child element, and this is where we now get that choice of composition, the parent-child, which is strong, the strong reference, or the weak reference. I'm going to choose parent-child. That's the default. And in this case, let's build two of them. We'll do area one and heat exchangers as we described. And now I'll go ahead and do another. Notice we haven't checked it in yet. Let's do another child element. No template to be basing this on at this point, and that's fine. We can build these without templates at this point. And we're going to call this heat exchangers. Now, once these look the way we want them, we'll go ahead and check those in. Those commits them to save them to the AF database.